Well, we're just throwing out a few extra words here. Deep time is what evolutionists often use to refer to millions of years. So that's just another way of talking about it, because it's just time way, 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 way back there. Davis Young is a very influential person in the Christian church. He is the professor emeritus of geology at Calvin College. And he's had a huge impact on the church, especially on theologians, regarding the question of the age of the earth. And in a book, Portraits of Creation, back in 1990, he said this: "If rocks are historical documents, we are driven to the related conclusion that the available evidence is overwhelmingly opposed to the notion that the Noahic flood deposited rocks of the Colorado Plateau, where the Grand Canyon is, only a few thousand years ago." So he is saying that the evidence proves that the flood had nothing to do with the Colorado Plateau and the Grand Canyon. He goes on, "The Christian who believes that the idea of an ancient earth is unbiblical would do better to deny the validity of any kind of historical geology and insist that the rocks must be the product of pure miracle rather than try to explain them in terms of the flood. An examination of the earth apart from ideological presuppositions is bound to lead to the conclusion that it is ancient." So he says the evidence shows that the flood had nothing to do with the producing the Colorado Plateau and the Grand Canyon. And if we would just look at the evidence without any ideological presuppositions, we'll come to the conclusion that the earth is millions of years old. Well, that kind of statement has had a huge impact on our theologians, which is why most of our seminary and Christian college professors accept millions of years. I'm not talking about the liberal schools, I'm talking about the evangelical schools. Because they have been led by Davis Young and others to the conclusion that the evidence just speaks for itself. And it's only the young earth creationists who have an ideological presupposition operating. I want to show you that that is influencing people. Dr. James Montgomery Boyce, a great Bible teacher and pastor of Presbyterian Church in Philadelphia, passed away a few years ago, wrote a very helpful commentary on the book of Genesis, in which he said, "We have to admit here that the exegetical basis of the creationists is strong." In other words, he's saying the biblical arguments that creationists develop to defend their young earth views, those are good arguments. "In spite of the careful biblical and scientific research that is accumulated in support of the creationist view, there are problems that make the theory wrong to most, including many evangelical scientists." What is the problem? He tells us. "Data from various disciplines point to a very old earth and even an older universe." Notice his choice of words. Data. What I want to argue, what we're arguing this whole week, what we want to get into your head is that it is not the data. It is the interpretation of the data which is based on certain assumptions or presuppositions. Dr. Boyce didn't understand that. Good Bible teacher, but he didn't understand that. And he was influenced by the writings of Davis Young and other people. Wayne Grudem, one of my favorite professors in seminary, I have great respect for him. He wrote a book, Systematic Theology, which is one of the most popular systematic theology texts used in evangelical seminaries and colleges today. And in that book, he says, although, in the chapter on creation, although our conclusions are tentative at this point in our understanding, Scripture seems to be more easily understood to suggest, but not to require, a young earth view, while the observable facts of creation seem increasingly to favor an old earth view. Notice the word observable facts. You just go out and observe the facts, and it speaks of millions of years. No, it's the interpretation of the facts based on certain assumptions. Or Gordon Lewis and Bruce Demarest, who produced another one of the most popular systematic theologies in Volume 2. They hold to the day-age view, as Dr. Boyce and Dr. Grudem lean towards that view. They conclude that, quote, ultimately responsible geology must determine the length of the Genesis days. What about sound exegesis of the text? And it's interesting that two theologians would say responsible geology determines the meaning of the text. As theologians, how do they know what responsible geology is? Is 200 years of uniformitarian secular geology responsible geology? That's a question. Gleason Archer, who passed away a few years ago, he taught Old Testament at the seminary where I attended. A great scholar. This book, A Survey of Old Testament Introduction, is very, very helpful. Have that in my library. He says, from a superficial reading of Genesis 1, the impression would seem to be that the entire creative process took place in six 24-hour days. But he didn't believe that. He held to the day-age view. If this was the true intent of the Hebrew author, one of the reasons he didn't believe in that is an argument that I gave you reasons to reject yesterday. That is, that too much happened on the sixth day to happen in 24 hours. But I think the real reason he didn't believe that is reflected in this statement. This seems to run counter to modern scientific research, which indicates that the planet Earth was created several billion years ago. Notice again the choice of words, scientific research. No, it wasn't the scientific research, it was the anti-biblical presuppositions that were used to interpret the scientific research. And then Bruce Waltke, one of the greatest Old Testament scholars today, taught at Dallas Seminary for many years. The days of creation may also pose difficulties for a strict historical account. Contemporary scientists almost unanimously discount the possibility of creation in 1 week, and we cannot summarily discount the evidence of the earth sciences. Notice his language again. No, it's not the evidence. It's the presuppositions that are used to interpret the evidence. And furthermore, creationists don't summarily reject or discount. We reject after we've spent a lot of time analyzing the logic of the evolutionists, as Dr. Lyle was talking about in the last session, and analyzing the evidence that they put forward and analyzing the assumptions that are hidden behind their interpretations. So we don't just summarily discount. So we really need to grasp that all of the scientists, whether they're evolutionists or creationists, whether they're intelligent design proponents or not, they all have the same, let's talk about geology, they all have the same rock layers and the same fossils to study. They can all go to the Grand Canyon and look at the same layers, and they can see that the Tapete sandstones are at the bottom of that stack and that the Kaibab limestones are at the top of the stack. That's the facts. The question is, how did those layers get there? How long did it take to deposit them? Were they deposited in a desert environment or underwater? And how did that hole get there? And presuppositions are critical to answering those questions. So if you start with assumptions A and go and look at the evidence, you will come up with interpretation A. But if you start with differing assumptions B, you will come up with a different interpretation. And the assumptions are critical. This reporter commented in about the evolutionary war in the Boston Globe, while scientists and creationists, now you see what he's just done? He's just labeled creationists as non-scientists. That's already prejudiced the statement. They often square off over the scientific evidence for evolution. The source of the ongoing debate is deeper, he says. This is not just, now he's quoting Michael Ruse, who's a philosopher of science and an atheist. This is not just a fight about dinosaurs or gaps in the fossil record, says the atheist philosopher Michael Ruse, speaking from his home in Florida. This is a fight about different worldviews. This is one of those times where I totally agree with the atheist. It is about worldviews. Here's a statement by a leading historian of geology, James Secord. And he's writing about a controversy in the early 19th century, in the 1830s, in geology. He said this, "Most significantly, recent work in cultural anthropology and the sociology of knowledge has shown that the conceptual framework that brings the natural world into a comprehensible form becomes especially evident when a scientist constructs a classification," he's talking about geology, so in this case, "a classification of a rock formation, previous experience, early training, institutional loyalties, personal temperament, and theoretical outlook are all brought to bear in defining particular boundaries as natural." So when a geologist goes out to look at the rocks, he's taking with him his previous experience, his institutional training, his loyalties, his own personal temperament, and his theoretical outlook. Well, the theoretical outlook, that's a big word. That's just another word for worldview. That's just another word for starting assumptions. James Hutton is the man who really started the ball rolling on uniformitarian geology. And he said in his book, he said in his lifetime, I've never been able to find the exact quote, but it's quoted by Arthur Holmes, The past history of our globe must be explained by what can be seen to be happening now, said Hutton. No powers are to be employed that are not natural to the globe, no action to be admitted except those of which we know the principle. Now notice what he's saying. He's saying if we're going to reconstruct the past history of the globe, then we must think a certain way. We must only rely on what we can see to be happening now. What's he just ruled out by insisting on that presupposition in his method? He's just ruled out creation and the flood. Creation isn't happening in the 19th century. The flood isn't happening in the 19th century. So he just ruled it out a priori before he has ever gone and looked at the rocks. And then he says, no powers are to be employed that are not natural to the globe. So now he's just ruled out the supernatural. He didn't come to that conclusion by doing laboratory experiments. He didn't come to that conclusion by going out and looking at the rocks. That was an a priori philosophical assumption that he brought to bear on the rocks. And he said, this is the way we must do historical geology. So from him, and then Charles Lyell took the ideas of Hutton and really refined them and made them very persuasive because he was a lawyer and he knew how to argue his case. From this, we get uniformitarian naturalism, which began to dominate geology by about 1840. And from that time on, every geologist, wherever he studied in the world, was trained to think like a uniformitarian naturalist. And there are three assumptions in this philosophy. First, that nature or matter is all that exists. Now, not all scientists believe that, but most scientists, even the ones who believe in God, do their science as if that was true. So they may believe in God on Sunday or at the Wednesday night prayer meeting, but when they're actually in the lab or when they're actually going out and looking at the Grand Canyon, they are thinking as if nature is all there is. The second assumption is that everything can and indeed must be explained by three things: time and chance and the laws of nature working on matter. If you have those three things, time and chance and the laws of nature, you can explain everything you see. You can explain the origin of stars and galaxies. You can explain the origin of the solar system. You can explain the origin of the rock layers. You can explain the origin of the first living cell. You can explain the diversification of that living cell into all the different plants and animals that we have today. You just need enough time, chance, and the laws of nature. You can explain it all. And then the third assumption of uniformitarian naturalism. Those are two statements of naturalism, but uniformitarian naturalism assumes, third, that the processes of geological change have always been operating in the past at the same rate, frequency, and power as we see today. So we have volcanoes and earthquakes and tsunamis and tornadoes and hurricanes. They happen today every so often, here or there. But as we reconstruct the past, we can't allow any more of those little catastrophes to happen or any greater in power than we observe today, because all things continue just as they have from the beginning of creation. So, if you go to the facts, the geology in this case, but it applies to biology and astronomy as well, and you start with uniformitarian naturalistic presuppositions, you will look at those rock layers, or you'll look at stars, or you'll look at living creatures, and you'll say, the evidence is pointing to an old Earth and no global flood. But if you start with biblical assumptions, and you look at the same rocks and fossils, or the same stars, or the same living creatures, you find that they make sense of the world, and it really does confirm what the Bible has to say. So I want to show you the power of these assumptions. Dov Ospovat is a very famous historian of geology, and in a review of a book, Charles Darwin and the Problem of Creation by Neil Gillespie, he says, Gillespie shows that the theological considerations played a major role in the biological science of Darwin's day, including Darwin's. And from this, Gillespie argues that the reason there's so much theology in Darwin's book, The Origin, is that theological issues were still live ones for Darwin, and more important, that special creation was a living and powerful idea among his professional colleagues, one that required him to attack it with whatever weapons would be effective, including ridicule. Do you see, Charles Darwin was not the unbiased, objective pursuer of truth. He had a theological agenda, and he was fighting a theological idea, and he just masqueraded that attack with his theory of evolution. We'll talk some more about Darwin's theology tomorrow night in my last session. Stephen Jay Gould and Niles Eldridge are evolutionists. Gould has passed away. But they are not gradualists. They reject slow, gradual Darwinian evolution and favor what they call punctuated equilibrium, that evolution has happened in spurts, real jerky evolution. And this, they've often criticized the gradualists, and they say this, as an a priori bias, phyletic gradualism, that is neo-Darwinian evolution, has precluded any fair assessment of evolutionary temples and modes. It could not be refuted by empirical catalogs constructed in its light. Why? Because it excluded contrary information. Well, that's deliberate. You just get rid of the information that doesn't fit your theory. They excluded it as an artificial result of an imperfect fossil record. There just aren't all the fossils to support gradualism aren't out there because the record is imperfect. Phyletic gradualism was an a priori assertion. That is, it came before they studied the fossil record, not as a result of studying the fossil record. It was an a priori assertion from the start. It was never seen in the rocks. It expressed the cultural and political biases of the 19th century liberalism. Another evolutionist puts it this way, Richard Lewontin, who at the time of this statement, as far as I know, still is professor of genetics at Harvard University. He's one of the leading evolutionists in America. He said, our willingness to accept scientific claims that are against common sense. And the evolutionary claims are that dinosaurs evolved into birds, that people evolved from ape-like creatures, that's contrary to common sense. It is the key to understanding the real struggle between science and the supernatural. Notice the labeling. Now, science doesn't have any room for the supernatural. Science is a method of studying the world. Supernatural is a being. It's a category confusion. We take the side of science in spite of the patent absurdities of some of its constructs, in spite of its failure to fulfill many of its extravagant promises of health and life, in spite of the tolerance of scientific communities for unsubstantiated just-so stories. I'm going to give you a couple of examples today. Because we have an a priori commitment, a commitment to materialism. Materialism is just another name for naturalism, which is another name for atheism. It is not that the methods and institutions of science somehow compel us to accept a material explanation of the phenomenal world, but on the contrary, that we are forced by our a priori adherence to material causes to create an apparatus of investigation and a set of concepts that produce material explanations no matter how mystifying to the uninitiated. Moreover, that materialism is absolute, for we cannot allow a divine foot in the door. Is he biased or unbiased? Why can't you allow a divine foot in the door? And it's not just Lewontin. The National Academy of Sciences is the highest scientific organization in America. And in 1998, a survey was done of the members of the National Academy, focusing on the members who are in the hard sciences, physics, geology, chemistry, biology. And they sent the survey to 517 members. Half of them responded to the survey. The survey was asking them two questions, both about their belief about the existence of God. So it's just a very short survey. Well, from the 50% who responded, 72% were overtly atheistic. 20% were agnostic. They're not sure whether there is a God or not. At least that's what they say. An agnostic is really just a cowardly atheist. They just don't want to say that they don't believe in God. So that left, of the respondents, only 7% who believe in a personal God. But that doesn't mean they're Christians. They could have been Jewish. They could have been Muslim. They could have just believed in some vaguely defined personal God. So what does that survey tell us? Well, we can probably safely conclude that the non-responders were probably unbelievers. Because if there was a believer in God in the National Academy of Sciences, he would want to register his presence there because he knows that the climate is very anti-God in our culture. So the ones who didn't bother probably were unbelievers. And it was an anonymous survey. So what does that tell us? Well, that tells us very clearly that the National Academy of Sciences is extremely anti-biblical in its orientation. They're not unbiased pursuers of truth. My son is a sheriff's deputy down in Florida. Imagine my son gets a call on his police radio, and it's the captain, and he says, Nate, I want you to go to 247 Sunside Road. There is a dead body in the living room, and I want you to investigate this carefully, and I want you to come up with a natural explanation, because your job is really important to you and your family, isn't it, Nate? And so you will find a natural explanation for that dead body, won't you, sir? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So my son goes to investigate the body. He's operating with a presupposition. I must find a natural explanation for this dead body. I cannot find any evidence for suicide or murder because those aren't natural explanations. Those are intelligently designed explanations. So I'm going to look for the evidence for a natural cause of death. What is he going to do? He's either unintentionally or intentionally going to overlook evidence if it in fact was a suicide or was murder. He's going to overlook it either consciously or unconsciously because He has a pressure working on him to find a natural explanation. Well, there's a lot of pressure in the academic scientific world to find natural explanations. If the vast majority of the members of the National Academy of Science are atheists, they're going to put a lot of pressure on the universities, on the science journals, on the U.S. government, politicians who don't know anything about science. In fact, I was at a conference of paleontologists in Cincinnati just a couple weeks ago. It was the quadrennial meeting of the North American Paleontological Society. And one of the lectures that I went to was by a PhD paleontologist who works for a lobbying think tank group in Washington, D.C. to influence our politicians. So there's tremendous pressure to come up with what we've already seen is it must be a natural explanation. Well, let's look at how these presuppositions work with some concrete examples. Stephen Jay Gould, I mentioned to you, he's one of the greatest evolutionists until his death in 2002 as a professor of Harvard University. And he said this, which is why he was not a gradualist in terms of evolutionary theory. The extreme rarity of transitional forms in the fossil record persists as the trade secret of paleontology. The evolutionary trees that adorn our textbooks have data only at the tips and nodes of their branches. The rest is inference, however reasonable, not the evidence of fossils. So he says, we have fossils that are at the tips and the nodes of the branches, but we don't have fossil evidence to support the many branches. In another place, he says this, we have direct evidence for large-scale changes based on sequences in the fossil record. Now, this contradicts what he just said, but let's look at what he says in detail here. He says, we have direct evidence of large-scale changes. The nature of this evidence is often misunderstood by non-professionals, condescendingly looking down his nose, who view evolution as a simple ladder of progress and therefore expect a linear array of missing links. Why do the non-professionals think that? Well, it's because the evolutionist experts present straight line diagrams of dinosaurs changing into birds and ape-like creatures changing into humans. That's that they're in the museums. That's why the non-professionals think that way, because the experts present it that way. But he goes on to say this, but evolution is a copiously branching bush, not a ladder, since our fossil record is so imperfect. We can't hope to find evidence for every twiglet. Sometimes we do discover an entire little bush, but such examples are as rare as they are precious. In the usual case, now he's going to give us the usual case, we may recover the remains of side branch number 5 from the bush's early, this is the evolutionary bush, from the bush's early history, then bough number 40 a bit later, then the full series of branches 156 to 161 in a well-preserved sequence of younger rocks, and finally, surviving twigs 250 and 287. That's what he says that we find. He goes on, such sequences provide superb examples of temporally ordered evolutionary trends. Consider the evidence of human evolution in Africa. Well, we don't have time to do that, so you just get David Menton's video, Lucy, She's No Lady, and you'll see what we think of that evidence from Africa. But let's go to the point that Gould makes. He says, this is the evidence we've got. We've got the little evidence here, number 5, number 40, on the evolutionary tree, and then numbers 156, 57, 8 through 61, that's a little bush. We've got those. So, from this, he imagines that all of those creatures are related to a common ancestor through millions of years of evolutionary change. But there's another way to interpret the evidence. Could mean that God created separate kinds of creatures, built into their DNA the potential for genetic variation to vary within their kind, but not to change into a different kind. So it's completely arbitrary to connect all of those little bushes and make them one big bush. That's imagination. That's assumptions controlling the evidence. It's not the evidence. Gould told us we don't have the evidence for the branches, but he assumes it. That is really much more faithful to what the evidence shows. Well, let's look at another example. Skull 1470, found in Lake Rudolph in Kenya in 1972. This rocked the evolutionary world when Richard Leakey announced it. Very human-like in appearance, but it was on the front cover of National Geographic, but it caused some problems and some controversy. And Marvin Lubinow, in his book Bones of Contention, tells the story, documents it. But initially, Leakey said that based on a volcanic tuff, by radiometric dating, this skull was 2.6 million years old. Now, if you were at Andrew Snelling's presentations the last few days, you know how reliable the radiometric dating methods are. Well, that was not acceptable to the scientific evolutionary establishment because you can't have a skull that is that human-like 2.6 million years ago, because man hadn't evolved that far 2.6 million years ago. So that date has got to be wrong. So then commenced a 10-year controversy among the evolutionists about the dating of this fossil. They used four methods to redate the fossil, and they got ranges from 500,000 to 17.5 million. Those are all basically around the same number, aren't they? Shows us just how accurate these methods are. They debated back and forth for 10 years, and finally, they settled it, not by radiometric dating, but on the basis of pig fossils that they found nearby, which gave them the date based on their assumption of evolution and what creatures evolved when in history, and so they revised the date to 1.9 million years. A statement about this whole process of dating the rocks was made by John Reeder, who is a leading evolutionary paleoanthropologist, in his book Missing Links. He said, more fundamentally, the dating controversy, which was over 10 years, shows that modern paleoanthropologists are no less likely to cling to erroneous data that supports their preconceptions than were early investigators. Dubois and the missing link, Java man, Leakey and the oldest man, both dismissed objective assessment in favor of the notions they wanted to believe. These people are not unbiased pursuers of truth. Another example. Phil Gingrich is professor of paleontology at the University of Michigan, and he's an expert on whale fossils. He grew up in the church, in a conservative church, by his own statement. And he said in a Journal for Geological Education, which is for teachers to read, science emerged from a philosophically motivated inquiry into the nature of our world, and it has usurped some of the mystery formerly included in religion. So science is a philosophically motivated, what he means by science is evolutionary science, is philosophically motivated. And it's replaced what religion used to teach us. Well, in that same journal in 1983, he presented a paper giving us some of the evidence for whale evolution. Evolutionists believe that whales evolved from land animals. And here you have a perfect transitional form. This creature is obviously part whale. The rear end is starting to evolve into a whale fin. And the creature's already eating fish. Still got a front end that's land creature-like. Those front legs are like land creatures. And in this article, he describes this creature this way. Pakicetus, it was called that because it was found, the fossils were found in Pakistan, and cetus is the Latin term for whale. So even in the naming of the creature, he's already assumed evolution. He says Pakicetus is the oldest and most primitive whale yet discovered. It is an important transitional form linking Paleocene, carnivorous land mammals, and later more advanced marine whales. Is there any question in his mind that this is a transitional form? The verbs are clear. It is. Now, what was the fossil evidence for this diagram? Notice this is not a photograph. This is a diagram. The fossil evidence was the head. No, it wasn't the head. It was just the stippled parts of the head. That's all the fossil evidence they had. And yet he could draw the body below the neck, or the artist could. He could draw the rear end of the creature based on parts of the skull. That's amazing. Well, that's 1983. I guess that's what you do when you get a PhD in paleontology. You can do that. That was 1983. In 1994, he wrote again in a different magazine, Natural History, which lay people read. In time and in its morphology, Pachycetus is perfectly intermediate, a missing link between earlier land mammals and later full-fledged whales. No question, perfectly intermediate. Well, that was 1994. 7 years later, in 2001, there was a technical article published in Nature, which is the leading technical journal in the English language, published in Great Britain. And they were summarizing all the fossil evidence that they had found for Pachycetus up to 2001. And here's the evidence that they had. Looks just like the skeleton of a whale, doesn't it? And based on what we know about anatomy and what kinds of muscles would be necessary to move those bones, we have a pretty good idea of what this creature looked like. Looks just like a whale. And in this article in Nature, they said, these creatures were terrestrial mammals, no more amphibious than a tapir. What's a tapir? That's a tapir. Now, they do like to swim in the water, but they are not sea creatures. They don't swim in the ocean. They're land animals, 100% land animals. So here we have an example of how Gingrich misinterpreted the fossil evidence based on an inadequate amount of fossil evidence and, as he himself admits, philosophically motivated assumptions. Another example, feathers for T-Rex. New bird-like fossils are missing links in dinosaur evolution. No question at all. This article published in 1999, November issue of National Geographic, had beautiful full-color pictures of what this creature looked like, Archaeoraptor lioningensis, because it was found in Liaoning province in northeastern China. And in big, bold fonts, they said, we can now say that birds are theropods, just as confidently as we say that humans are mammals. Well, what are theropods? Theropods are those kinds of creatures, which Dr. Menton graphically showed us last night, have these little front legs. But notice the creature that they supposedly evolved into. It's got these huge wings. The article says, we can say the birds are dinosaurs just as confidently as we say that humans are mammals. Now, is there any question that humans are mammals? We give birth to live young. We feed our live young milk. We have hair. We're mammals. We're more than mammals, but we're mammals. We're not reptiles. We're not birds. They said, we're just as confident that birds are theropods. Well, that was November 1999. In January of 2000, just 2 months later, a Chinese paleontologist wrote to the National Geographic, and they published his letter to the editor, just a little short one, in which he said in so many words, I hate to inform you this, but the fossil that you paid $80,000 for that was the basis for that article was a fraud. Yep, it was parts of a reptile fossil and parts of a bird fossil glued together very carefully by some very clever Chinese farmers who needed some extra money. Well, the National Geographic commissioned an independent investigator to find out how this fraud happened. And he wrote an article in October of 2000, so about 11 months later. It was stuck in the back of the magazine with no color pictures, a few large font statements. I wonder how many people who read the November 1999 article with the big, bold claims and the color pictures, ever read the article almost a year later. You know that people don't read National Geographic because pictures are worth 1,000 words and people are busy, so they look at all the beautiful photography. Well, that article ended this way. It's a tale of misguided secrecy and misplaced confidence, of rampant egos clashing, self-aggrandizement, wishful thinking, naive assumptions, human error, stubbornness, manipulation, backbiting, lying, corruption, and most of all, abysmal communication. It's a story in which none of the characters look good. Scientists are just fine, upstanding, truthful, unbiased, objective pursuers of truth. What about geology? Well, in the 19th century, you had three competing views of Earth history, which I need to give you just a brief lesson before I show you a very interesting quote by a modern geologist. You had the biblical view defended by a group of men called the scriptural geologists, which were the object of my PhD research, and I write about in The Great Turning Point. So they believed in a supernatural creation week, SCW, about 6,000 years ago, and then the global flood at the time of Noah, and then the earth recovering from that event up to the present time. But in the early 19th century, late 18th and early 19th century, you had another view that developed that became known as the catastrophist view. And the catastrophists like Cuvier in France and William Smith in England, they were theists. They believed in God, so they believed there was a supernatural beginning to the world, SB. But then, after God made the first living creatures, they did not accept evolution, and there were evolutionary theories at this time before Darwin. They believed that after a long period of time, there was a catastrophic flood of global or continental scale that wiped out most or all of the creatures living at the time. The earth was repopulated by either survivors or God supernaturally creating more creatures to fill the earth. Life went along for a long period of time. There was another catastrophic flood of a global or continental scale that wiped out most or all of the creatures. And then the earth recovered from that with or without supernatural creations from God. And this happened many, many times in history over untold ages. They were clearly thinking millions of years. That view dominated geology for about the first three decades of the 19th century. But it was replaced by the view that we've already alluded to, the uniformitarian view of James Hutton and Charles Lyell. And from their writings, historians of science are not sure whether they were theists or not. They might have been deists, they might have been secret atheists, because in Great Britain at this time, it was culturally unpopular, socially rather unacceptable to be an atheist. So people would often hide their true views with a little bit of God language. But you can see on their timeline, there are no seas. That is, there were no continental or global catastrophic floods in Earth history. Oh, a little flood here, a little flood there, every so often, that's fine. But nothing on a global or continental scale. Well, that view became the ruling view in geology by about 1840. And as I said, everybody from that time on, if they went to study geology in the university, they were taught to think like a uniformitarian. Something very amazing happened. In the 1970s, some evolutionary geologists began to challenge that worldview, that presupposition about the rocks. And so I want to read to you a statement by one of those men. His name is Derek Ager. He was professor of geology and head of the department at the University of College Swansea in Wales for over 20 years. He was president of the British Geological Association. He had visited more than 50 countries of the world studying geological formations. And he died in 1993 as what became known as a neo-catastrophist. And in a book on the stratigraphic record, the nature of the strata, and he's writing to his fellow evolutionary geologists, he says this. He's got a short section on history, looking back at the early 19th century. And he says, "My excuse for this lengthy and amateur digression into history is that I have been trying to show how I think geology got into the hands of the theoreticians," in his mind, in the context, that's clearly the uniformitarians, "who were conditioned by the social and political history of their day more than by observations in the field." So the uniformitarians, this evolutionary geologist, and as far as I can tell from his writings, he probably died an atheist, he said those uniformitarians of the early 19th century were more controlled by social and political ideas in their heads than by actual observations of the rocks. He goes on to say this to his fellow evolutionary geologists. "In other words, we have allowed ourselves to be What's that word? Brainwashed. It's not my word, that's his. Brainwashed into avoiding any interpretation of the past that involves extreme and what might be termed catastrophic processes. Now I'm going to illustrate brainwashing. I'm going to show you a picture of an old lady. And she is looking off to your, off to your left. And it's really cold. She's got a big, thick sweater or a piece of cloth up around her neck. She's cold. She's got a scarf on. And you'll be able to see it as soon as I show you the picture. There she is. She's looking over here. She's got a big nose and a little bit of wart on her nose up there. Everybody see the old lady? Okay. Actually, I just brainwashed you. That's not an old lady. That's a young lady. And the young lady is not looking out in this corner. She's looking back in that corner. And what you thought was the nose is really her left jaw. And what you thought was the left eye of the old lady was really the left ear of the young lady. And the young lady, what you thought was the mouth of the old lady is really a little choke chain that the young lady is wearing. And what you thought was an old lady is really a young lady. Now, think about this. The facts are the black lines and the white spaces. The interpretation of the facts is old lady or young lady. And what you see depends on what you're looking for. See, we all have the same facts, the same fossils, the same stars, the same living creatures, the same earth. But the starting assumptions, if you start with anti-biblical assumptions, uniformitarian or even catastrophist assumptions that rule out the flood, you'll come up with evolution in millions of years. But if you start with biblical assumptions, it really does fit with what the Genesis record tells us. And so the more that we study the evidence, the more we see problems. That fossil was not a transitional form between theropod dinosaurs and birds. Millions of years doesn't fit. And the reason it doesn't is because the assumptions are wrong. But the biblical assumptions, when we really look at the world, they fit the facts. And so as Jason was talking about, it's really a battle of worldviews. It's not a battle about the facts. It's a battle about the assumptions that are used to interpret the facts. And so it depends on what kind of glasses that we're wearing. Well, we've come a ways now. We mentioned Derek Ager talking about catastrophism. And so now we don't really have pure uniformitarians anymore, although uniformitarianism still has a huge impact. And it's kind of the default explanation, slow, gradual processes, unless there's a lot of compelling evidence for catastrophe. And so we have what could be called catastro-uniform geology or uniform catastrophism geology. And Gould says this, most geologists would tell you that their science represents the total triumph of Lyell's uniformity over unscientific catastrophism of the early 19th century. But modern geology is really an even mixture of two scientific schools, Lyell's original rigid uniformitarianism and the scientific catastrophism of Cuffier and Agassiz, who is an American geologist. Gradualism was never proved from the rocks by Lyell and Darwin, but was rather imposed as a bias upon nature. It has had a profoundly negative impact by stifling hypotheses and by closing the minds of a profession toward reasonable empirical alternatives to the dogma of gradualism. Well, you know what, folks? The Stephen Jay Goulds, the neo-catastrophists of the 20th century, are still imposing a bias on nature that rules out the Bible, and so they are stifling hypotheses. The flood could not have produced the layers of the Grand Canyon. That's impossible to even consider in modern geology, unless you're a creationist. And so it's closing minds from considering an alternative to the millions of years idea. Gould said, Lyell won with rhetoric what he could not carry with data. Derek Eger, in his last book, which was published just after he died, The New Catastrophism, which is a wonderful book, I just rejoice on almost every page because he gives example after example of things that uniformitarians used to say took long ages to produce, and he says, we now know the evidence is overwhelming. These were produced catastrophically, and they're great. He said, perhaps I'm becoming a cynic in my old age, but I cannot help thinking that people find things that they expect to find. As Sir Edward Bailey said, to find a thing, you have to believe it to be possible. Well, what are the impossible beliefs for most modern geologists? What are the things that they say, that's just impossible to believe that? I cannot believe that that's possible. Well, it's very simple. It's impossible to believe that the Bible is the inspired word of God and Genesis 1 to 11 is accurate literal history. It's impossible to believe that God created distinct kinds of plants and animals with potential for great variation within their kind. It's impossible to believe in a creation week of six literal days about 6,000 years ago. And it's impossible to believe that Noah's flood was global and unimaginably catastrophic. We can't allow those ideas in our thinking, say that most modern scientists. Well, let's look at a couple of key assumptions in geology, but they're false assumptions. I'm going to demonstrate that they're false assumptions. This assumption, this first one, is absolutely key to the whole evolutionary story about history. The absence of fossils of a creature in a particular geological formation or rock layer is evidence of the non-existence of that creature when that sedimentary layer was deposited. That is a driving assumption of the whole evolutionary view and the development of old Earth geology. You see, they look at the rock record and they find different creatures fossilized in different layers. And so they find man up in recent layers at the top of the geological column, and they find dinosaurs deeper in the rock record, and they say that's proof positive that man wasn't alive when the dinosaurs existed. And they don't find dinosaurs down with the trilobites in the lower rock record, so that's proof positive that the dinosaurs didn't exist when the trilobites existed. Because the absence of a creature in a particular layer is proof positive that the creature didn't exist at the time that that layer was deposited. And that's why the old Earth catastrophists of the early 19th century believed that the rock record was formed before Adam was created. Because they said, we don't find man buried down in the lower rock layers. I want to show you that that's a false assumption. It's absolutely critical to modern geology and evolutionary thinking, but it's false, demonstrably false. One of the evidences is living fossils. The coelacanth was thought to have gone extinct with the dinosaurs 65 million years ago, because as we come up through the rock record, that's the last level where we find the coelacanth in the fossil record. And so they said it went extinct. They said that until 1938, when they found the coelacanth swimming off the coast of Madagascar in 400 feet of water. And when they compared the living coelacanth to the fossil, it was virtually identical. They've since found coelacanths in fishing villages, fish markets in Japan and Indonesia. Now, nobody believes that the coelacanth evolved into existence in 1937 and just happened to be identical to the one that went extinct. It was in existence all during that time, although it wasn't 65 million years, even though there's no fossil evidence. Or the Wollemi pine, thought to have gone extinct 150 million years ago, found living in 1994 in Sydney, Australia, near Sydney, Australia, only about less than 100 miles from where the fossils have been found. And they're virtually identical to the living. This plant did not evolve into existence the year before they were discovered. Or this little guy, a rock rat, died out supposedly 11 million years ago because as they came up through the rock record, there were no rock rats in the rock record above that. In fact, the article here refers to this as the coelacanth of the rodents. And yet, they found this rodent in a market, a meat market, in Southeast Asia. A recently discovered fossil of this creature matched the living specimen. I don't know why they put the living in quotation marks, because it really is living. In skull shape and overall size. The only difference is that the living specimen's teeth are slightly more pointed. Well, whoopee. You know, a little sharper teeth. Maybe it's because the guy that was fossilized was chewing on rocks or something, you know. But they gave it a different genus name. It's the same creature. Yet we have no fossil evidence for the rocks that are dated between 11 million and the present. Or this creature, a slit shell, found in rock layers dated to be 500 million years old, long thought to be extinct, discovered alive in our oceans in 1855. So living fossils are proof that the assumption that the absence of a creature in a particular rock layer means that the creature wasn't in existence at the time the rock layer was deposited. But you know what? The evolutionists know this, and they use it when they want to. Listen to this statement by Ernst Mayr, who was professor of zoology at Harvard University. In his book, What Evolution Is, which is written for lay people, he says, the fossil record of the earliest plants is very poor. Fossils of mosses, generally considered the most primitive of the living land plants, have been found from the Devonian period, but surely they existed earlier, but didn't fossilize. Oh, now wait a minute. I thought you said that if there's no fossil evidence for a creature, that meant it didn't exist at that time. Oh, well, that's an inconvenient fact, because we got to explain how these plants came into existence, and they couldn't have just popped into existence straight away. They must have evolved from mosses. And even though we don't have any fossil mosses deeper in the rock record, they must have been there. See, so you use the absence when you want to, and you ignore it when you don't want to. That's called being selective. Or the horseshoe crab. In a rock layer dated to be 190 million years old, we have this in the museum. It looks just like a living horseshoe crab. And here's another version in a rock layer dated 445 million years. And it looks just like the modern ones. In an article about this, they said, two nearly complete fossil specimens discovered in Canada reveal a new genus of horseshoe crab. It's still a horseshoe crab. It's not something other than a horseshoe crab, pushing their origins back at least 100 million years earlier than previously thought. This is happening all the time in geology and paleontology. They're finding a creature that they thought appeared at this stage in evolution, and then they find it deeper in the rock layer, and they have to change their evolutionary story. So, the absence of evidence is not the evidence of absence. And you cannot use the fossil record to say that man didn't exist with the trilobites, because the absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. Another key assumption, fossil deposits represent ecosystems. So if we look at a fossil deposit, we can figure out what animals lived together, what they ate, because they're all in the same layer together. But that's ridiculous, and there's good evidence that that's not true. The Karoo Formation in South Africa, one evolutionist estimated, surely an overestimate, but there are a lot of fossils there. He estimated 800 billion vertebrates all jumbled together in a massive deposit. The Florissant Colorado Formation has shell creatures, some fish and birds, and hundreds of species of plants and insects. Now, listen. Birds and fish don't live in the same ecosystem. One lives in air, the other lives in water. So buried all together, this is not preserving an ecosystem. And the Agate Springs, Nebraska deposits, which I have a picture of there, has thousands of fossils of rhinoceros, camels, giant boars, and many other exotic animals all mixed together in limestone. That is a mess. That's not a preserved ecosystem. In the Cumberland Bone Cave, remains of dozens of species of mammals ranging from bats to mastodons are found in the cave together with some reptiles and birds from different types of climates, from Arctic to tropical, and habitats from dry prairies to humid wet regions. They're not buried together preserving a single ecosystem. They're buried in a mess. We have in the Grand Canyon the evidence of a mass kill event, the Red Wall Limestone. There's a section of that 400-foot thick bed in the Grand Canyon that covers 11,000 square miles, and there are nautiloids found in a small, thin section of that. I think it's about 2 or 3 meters thick, running through this whole sedimentary layer. This is what the creature was when it was alive. The modern nautiloid, Nautilus, is a curved, coiled version of this creature. And they found 15% of the fossils are in an upright position with the point down. Now, can you imagine that creature falling just gradually in its ecosystem, and it plops in the sediments on the bottom of the ocean? It just stays there, standing straight up for thousands of years as sediments just trickle down and slowly bury it. It's a mass kill event, and Stephen Austin, a creationist geologist, studied the orientation of these long conical fossils and found that it's showing an orientation that they were killed in a mass kill wave going from the southeast to the northwest. But that's exactly what we would expect from the flood, which was designed to kill man and the animals and the creeping things and the birds of the sky, and even to destroy the earth itself, Genesis 6 says. And the mechanism was the breaking up of the fountains of the great deep and the floodgates of the sky. And that language, if we had time to unpack all of that, is speaking of catastrophic changes to the earth. Earthquakes and volcanoes and flooding of unimaginable scale. And the heavy rains would produce mudslides that would make the mudslides in Southern California every year look like a Sunday school picnic on a sunny day. And look at that mud deposit. Do you think that's preserving nicely an ecosystem? No, it's a mess. And that the flood would have had tsunamis with earthquakes and volcanic eruptions on the bottom of the ocean. Tsunamis like the one in Southeast Asia that killed 280,000 people. And scientists studying the worst hit areas imagined that the ocean rose 80 to 100 feet above sea level. So creatures are not buried where they lived. They're not even buried where they died, probably in most cases. But they're buried where they were buried by catastrophic floodwaters. So the assumptions are critical. They affect they influence or control the questions we ask when we go out to look at something. They control or affect what we see in our research. Like my son going to the scene of a dead body, and his presuppositions are controlling what he sees or what he looks for. They influence what data we collect, what things you write down is controlled by your assumptions. And they influence or control the interpretations of the data. When Steve Austin first started investigating the nautiloids in the Red Wall Limestone, the National Park Service already knew that the nautiloids existed, and they called the place where they found them Nautiloid Canyon. But they were not interested in studying the nautiloids. It was just a fossil. They had no idea how many of them were in the canyon and elsewhere, because they weren't motivated to ask the question. But Steve Austin was a creationist. He believed in a global flood. And he started thinking. And he said, if the flood really happened, I bet you we might find these nautiloids somewhere else. I bet you we might find some very interesting things about the nature of this rock layer and how fast it was laid down by studying those nautiloids. And that's what drove him to ask the questions and do the observations that he made. Colossians says, see to it that no one takes you captive through philosophy and empty deception according to the tradition of men, according to the elementary principles of the world, rather than according to Christ. For the last 200 years, most of the church has been taken captive by philosophy and empty traditions of men without realizing it. Most of our seminary professors have been taken captive by philosophy and empty deception without realizing it. They think that it's the data. It's the scientific research that points to millions of years. No, it's the assumptions. So we have this evolutionary theory to explain all of reality. Astronomical evolution explains the origin of the cosmos and the stars and the galaxies and the comets and the stardust. Geological evolution picks up the story about 4.5 billion years ago with the formation of our Earth. And then over millions of years, the rock layers were formed by time and chance and the laws of nature. And then biological evolution picks up the story about 3.5 billion or 2 billion years ago with the formation, just by chance, of the first living cell, and then the diversification of all the plants and animals over millions and millions of years. It's a story to explain all of reality, just as Genesis is a story to explain all of reality. But Genesis is history, and this story is myth. It's all based on the assumptions of philosophical naturalism, and it's all a grand myth. Another way to view that three-part theory is with a rope, a stranded rope. And is it Ecclesiastes that says that a three-stranded rope is not easily broken? Biological, geological, and astronomical evolution. The theistic evolutionist is tied up by all three strands. He's completely tied up with naturalistic thinking. He may believe in God, but his thinking is naturalistic. The progressive creationist rejects biological evolution. He's cut loose from biological evolution, but he still accepts geological evolution and astronomical evolution. And he says, and I could quote progressive creationists who say that biological evolution is naturalism. And so by cutting loose from biological evolution, we're free of naturalism. No, you're only free from one strand of naturalism. It's the biblical creationist who's really cut loose because he's believing the word of God. And Jesus said, if you abide in my word, then you are truly disciples of mine, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. And really free. Free indeed.